So Will Blake. Hey Blake. You're muted.
You would think the host would know how to unmute themselves. Thank you all again for joining us today with the International Association of Woodcarvers. Today is November the 28th at 3 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, and I thank you all for joining us. Thanks for taking time out of your week to tune in. Just wanted to say thank you all for all your support and for following us from week after week. This is our 32nd week since we started doing these meetings. We started with Larry Green back on April the 18th, so that kind of tells you how long we've been doing this. And again, for all you all that join us each week and for all the new followers, we thank you all for all the support and for joining in during these meetings. Today, we've got Jim Feather on. Jim was on with us a few weeks back. He did a presentation, and he's going to do another demonstration today on carving ornaments out of scrap wood. Before we get started with Jim, I wanted to go through the list of people that we've got signed up to do presentations going forward. Again, next week we have Mr. Larry Green that's going to be on. Larry actually started these meetings for us back on April the 18th. He was our very first presenter. He's coming back to do a demonstration on carving a Christmas tree. So we'll welcome Larry next week. Following Larry, we have Ryan Olson that's going to be coming on. Ryan is a member of the CCA. Ryan also is doing a class in January. It's the second and third weekend in January on a female bust. So if you're interested in his class, make sure you go out and contact Ryan and sign up for that. After Ryan, we have Wayne Larimore, who's also a member of the CCA. He's going to be on December the 19th. And then our first presenter of 2021 will be Mike Pounder. So Mike's agreed to come on and present for us on January the 2nd. You'll notice on December the 26th, which is a Saturday, we don't have anyone scheduled for that day. We're going to take off for the Christmas holiday, but we'll be right back on January the 2nd. I want to remind you all of some of the classes because, again, we want to share as much wood carving information as we can. Dave Stetson has a male bust class coming up beginning of December. So if you're interested in Dave's class, make sure you reach out to him in December. Kevin Applegate has two classes coming up. Kevin presented with us last week, and he will be happy to get online with you and teach how to do bottle stoppers and shorty Santas. He also does one-on-one coaching. Mr. Chris Hammock is doing design and carving classes, so if you're interested in learning how he designs his caricatures and get some information from Chris as far as carving, reach out to him. And again, Ryan Olson has a class that's the second and third weekend in January. So having said all that, we'll go ahead and turn this over to Jim Feather. And Jim, we appreciate you joining us today. Jim's coming to us from Pennsylvania. He's a member of the Conewago Carvers and Lancaster Carvers group up there in Pennsylvania. And Jim, we look forward to hearing from you. Thank you.
Well, great. Well, thanks for asking me to come back. It was a good time last time. Hopefully it'll be a good time this time. So I want to get myself organized here so that I can see what I'm doing. Right now I see Blake. Okay. So what I'm gonna do today is we're just gonna do a little demo on carving scrap pieces of wood. And then it's basically cutoffs, anything that I take off of other carvings. Whenever I'm doing if I'm doing a competition piece or if I'm doing a piece for just a larger carving, I have a tendency not to throw much away. And even whenever I'm taking my piece to the bandsaw, if I can do it in a way that I can take a little larger pieces off and not so many little ones, I'll do that. Because I use that extra wood then for ornaments and so forth. Most of the time I have a knife and a piece of wood in my pocket wherever I go and sit and carve a little bit. Get a lot of people. If my wife goes shopping at the outlets, you'll find me on a park bench outside and I'll be carving. People stop by and ask me what's going on, what I'm doing, what I'm working on, and make a lot of friends that way. I've carved all over the, I've carved in front of a lot of stores, let's put it that way. But I enjoy it. And like I said, not every piece is a work of art, but then again, doesn't need to be, as long as you enjoy it. That's what I like about carving, is that some of them are, you can do carving, wood carving, anywhere from a craft to an art. And these aren't pieces that are masterpieces. They're not competition pieces. They're something that you can entertain yourself with. But I was just going to go over, do a little demo of what I do and how I do it and how I pick the wood and what I try and look for in the wood. And that way I can, I can see, you know, my wife just handed me a note. What to say? No, right now all I can see is Blake too. So I don't know if it's on your end, Blake, or not, but I can see you. And I can do a expand at the bottom, but I can't get where I'm the active speaker.
So we'll see if Tom can work on that. I'm not sure what the issue is we're working on.
Oh, there I am. There he is. Now I'm active speaker. Okay. Tom must have worked on that. Okay. Yeah, that's better. Now I can see myself talk, which is confusing as I'll get up. Anyhow, what I'm doing is I'm going to show you a few carvings that I've done. And just to give you an idea, well, I'm going to flip this around here. You're going to see something for a few minutes. I have some tape lined up on my bench so that you can see what I'm looking at. There we go. I've got a few pieces. Like this is a typical, this is like what you're left over after you take a piece of wood and you cut your bandsaw, do your bandsaw cut. You might have a couple things that you've cut out. And when I teach classes and I do cutouts for classes, quite often I end up with a lot of the same shape cutouts. So I'll use them. And this is what I typically what I made out of this one. You can see that there's enough there to be able to do a little Santa Claus. And the guy doesn't have any feet. The reason I don't have any feet is I don't have any wood for any feet, but he's an ornament. He doesn't need any feet, you know, not going anywhere anyhow. But you can certainly just kind of look in the wood to what you're trying to do is just, you know, have a piece of wood that you can fool around with a knife. This piece, what I'm looking for though, is when I'm going to take a piece and I'm going to work on it, I need the grain going in the right direction. If you take a piece of wood and the grain's this way, all right, well, it's not going to really do you much good unless you're going to make really small carvings, because you have to keep in mind grain direction. And like I said, we have a lot of people on. I don't know the experience level of all the carvers here, but that's the one thing you do need to watch is your grain direction. A couple other examples here of this one here is another one that you can see. It's just what's left over. Usually I have a flat side on one. That doesn't really bother me. So I started doing a little bit here with this one. And it's coming out of the wood that way, you know. So I just did something that'll fit in your pocket. You can do it with a knife easily, something that you carry around with. These carvings here, I'll throw these all the way. These carvings here are all carved from you know, the cutoff pieces. I used the like I said, a lot of them have a flat area on them. This guy here, yeah, he's a lot of fun, but the reason his mouth and his face is that way is because when you turn him, he's still flat. It doesn't really matter. It's not much what I had to use, so I use for what it's worth, you know. A lot of times I'll use that flat area and that's where I'll end up signing it, is, you know, kind of a flat system. I'm not looking to make a correct, you know, his head might not be quite as deep as it should be. I'm not starting with a piece of wood and trying to make him perfectly symmetrical. I'm looking at the piece of wood and saying, what can I do with this piece of wood? It's fun. And that's what it is. It's just a pastime. It's a lot of fun. And the ornaments, I mean, everyone is different. So I know a lot of the guys that have done demos, and all the guys that do that teach all the time, I mean, I teach quite often, I'll go with a cutout. We'll go and we'll process and carve and measure and, you know, how you make a duplicate of this carving. This isn't really going to be that, but what I'm going to be talking about is what I look for, what I try to do, and how you can incorporate that maybe into your own carvings. Maybe there's things that I do that you'll hopefully you'll think, oh yeah, that'll be, that's it. I maybe remember that, or there'll be other things I do and it's like, oh man, I'm never going to do that. Okay, it doesn't bother me. A few more pieces. Some of these are just out of cutouts. The same thing like with this guy. Now there's plenty of room for a face, but whenever I had him, I didn't do this. This is the way it was. And then coming out, I needed obviously something. And a lot of times he came out of the regular piece of wood this way. I'll take a look and see which way I have to go with him. Sometimes it's a little extreme. This guy here, there's obviously not a lot of wood to work with there. So what I ended up doing was more cartoony, less caricature, more cartoon, but he's still a lot of fun. Yeah, he hangs on a tree just fine. This guy here, he didn't have a whole lot of wood to go with down here. So he has a very weak chin, but he has buck teeth. He's a happy guy. So that's the type of thing that I like to do with my scraps. A lot of times I don't bother. Sometimes it's just a small sliver or something. Well, you know, go ahead and carve it up. It's a lot of fun. Not everything we have to do, not everything we carve has to be a masterpiece. You know, let's put it that way. This guy here has again, you can still see where the flat areas are. I don't worry too much about that. I'm just doing this to have a good time. I need one to put the hand in, but I didn't really have enough wood to do everything with. So I just pushed the beard over and put the hand in his pocket. Okay. What I'm going to do is start with a piece of wood that I did cut off here. And by the way, anybody that wants to unmute and ask a question, feel free. I'm kind of like out here. And like I said before, it's a little quiet on this end. So if you feel like asking a question while I go, I can certainly talk while I'm carving. What I'm going to do is this one here, I took off of another piece of a carving that I was cutting out, and I had to get rid of some waste wood. I think this is actually part of a suitcase. And then I had to cut it at an angle just because I didn't feel like carving all this down. You know, so I ended up with this piece of wood. So we're going to see what we can do with it today. So but if anybody has any questions, feel free to ask. The last one I did was on expressions. I like to do faces, and this is the holiday time. So I'm going to do a Christmas one here. We'll probably put a face in this thing here, but we'll see where it goes. What I'm going to do is I'm going to take this, and I like the grain in this is going this way. So I can see, you probably can see almost on the camera. Yeah, you can see which way the grain is going there. That's one of the main things. Like I said, if the grain was going this way, I could do somebody laying down, but it would be a little bit more of a challenge to actually, you know, because a lot of cross grain, you want to make sure that you have strength. You know, if the grain is going this way, when you're done with your carving, it's going to be a little bit brittle right in here. But in this case, it's got a lot of strength coming up in here. So I can do what I want. I typically don't do a whole lot of sketching whenever I do this, but it's each his own. What I'm going to do is I'm just going to start here taking this out. And since you can see the top, I've got an odd shape here. And you can see where the rings in the tree is. I'm going to go ahead and plan on just rounding this out. And what I'll typically do is start with the hat on a Santa. And that's what I'm going to do. I don't always do Santas, but I am going to do one today. And we'll see how far we get. I just start with the hat because I like to do a couple things whenever I do these. I want to get the hat, figure out where the bottom of the hat is if I'm doing an ornament. And I'll go ahead and rough in the hat so I have an idea of where the face is going to be. And it really doesn't, it depends on the piece of wood. on this guy, I could do a lot with it. I'm going to do a hat here, I think, and just maybe put the ball of the hat back in here and run the hat down. And then I like to, even if I don't turn my carving or it's such a small little ornament, I like to give the impression of a little bit of motion, even if it's just the face is turned a little bit. So I'll probably run the face, you know, with the nose coming down either one of these creases here, probably anticipate having the face here. I'll go ahead and rough in the hat, and then I'll carve the face so that I know how big the face is. Because then I'll go back in and tailor the hat down to match it. Quite often when you're doing something like this, this piece of wood, this is about as big of a face as I could get in it. But when I was doing this guy, I had a big area here. I put the face right there and then tailored everything else down from that. This is one that my wife, I think, says only a relative would love. But I had a lot of wood here, you know, so I could do a nice grinning face and give him some buck teeth. You gotta have fun with it. Gotta have fun with it. Go ahead and get a little bit of this wood off here. You'll see I'm going right along with the grain, so it's coming off fairly quickly and easily. I'll try to remember to do a little bit of a tip here and there, as I do whenever I teach classes as well. I'm coming up to the edge, and right here is the cross grain. So like right, I'll get my hand out of the way. There you go. I got a little bit of a cross grain there, you know, coming across this way. Whenever you're, if you start carving, you know, they'll start working it. It's always good to work the corners. It helps you get the wood off a little quicker, but don't feel like you have to carve quickly. If you just started, make little chips. It's a little safer. But I always work the corner, especially when I'm coming up on the cross grain like that. Work the corner. And then I'll come in and work the corner again to round it. Right. I'm still carving up along with the grain. You need to watch your grain direction. And I'm just kind of, you know, a lot of the carvers on here, I'm sure, are well aware of that. But I want to make sure that any beginners, you know, watch your grain direction. Once you get your grain direction down, and if you have a good sharp knife, you'll enjoy carving more. I like to get rid of my saw marks, just because they annoy me. Pet peeves. So I'm starting to round it down a little bit. Whenever I'm carving, I tend to you'll see I'm holding my knife against my thumb, using my thumb as a pivot. Whenever I'm carving, I like to know where that knife is going, and my finger is not out in front of it. And by doing it as a pivot, it's not going anywhere. You don't see me going like this. I don't do that. If I do that, yeah, you lose control as soon as that knife leaves the wood. So I'll do it that way. And the same thing is whenever I'm coming toward my thumb, I'm not really coming toward my thumb. If you watch, I'm rolling my hand. I'm going this way. Not like coming into my thumb. I've had a few carvers in classes that carve into their thumb and it makes me shake. But only had a couple of people that ended up in the emergency room at the classes. And it wasn't because of the instructor. I just wanted to clear. It's definitely not the instructor's fault. Yeah, a couple arteries hit. But what I'm going to do here is I'm going to put a face down in here, but I'm going to kick this ball on this hat, and I'm going to put it back in here. And since I had so much wood up here, I'm going to try and push it over to the side a little bit. Every piece of wood is a little different, and that's what's fun. You know, you just go with it. And it's fine that you can You can work off of rough outs. You can work off of cutouts, and you know what your carving is supposed to look like when you're done. Or maybe you're working off of finishing a project that you started in a class. And those carvings are fine, but you have to really think about them as you're doing it. When you're doing something like this, you can you just kind of wing it. Go with the flow. Do what you like to do. You know, maybe you want to change it a little bit. Really don't know what this guy's going to look like until we're done. It's a little more enjoyable that way. There's other things I could do. I mean, I could do a pirate here with a feather in his hat. I can do whatever I want here, but right now I'm going to do a Santa because it's the holiday season, you know? I can see a few of you guys up on the bottom at least, you know? Yeah. Every once in a while, somebody just maybe wake up and look out across, and at least I'll know that people are still awake. Just keep Bob Hershey muted. Otherwise, he'd snore a little bit. He's seen me do this lots of times. There we go. Starting to get it in here a little bit. Now, I know my face is going to be down in this area, so the hat's going to be coming up in here. So I'm going to go ahead and pull that back a little bit. I'm glad I picked a decent piece of wood to do this demo. It's hard to do a demo with crappy wood. I've done it. It drives you nuts. Get some of this stuff out of my way.
Hey, Jim, while you're carving there, I just want to come on and tell everybody we've hit 100 people participating today. So that's a record for us. And if you hear anybody that comes on the internet and says, hey, wanted to come out and watch your meeting, but we weren't able to because we weren't able to get on. Our Zoom meeting will only allow 100 people on at one time, which is where we're at right now. So again, want to thank you all for coming out and participating in this. It's been great to see how it's grown. And Jim, we look forward to what you're doing here today. And thank you again for demonstrating for us.
Cool. Well, that's great. 100 people. That's not unnerving at all. Hope I don't cut myself, or 100 people in this country and in Canada, obviously, are going to see me bleeding all over my desk.
Yeah, no pressure.
No pressure. No. Well, hopefully I'll do something that at least a couple of those people will find useful. Okay, I'm getting it down. You can see, I think, a little bit about where I'm going with the hat. Yeah, there we go. You can tell that a lot of my carvings when I do them are not necessarily symmetrical. Most of that is intentional, most of it. Sometimes it's not, but if it's not symmetrical, it's a little more interesting. Okay, now this, I got this down here pretty good. Let's go a little bit thinner there, there we go. That's still pretty strong. I can do a lot with that. I'll go ahead and do some of this here. A lot of it I do with a knife. I enjoy using a knife. I do have a lot of gouge work that I do, but to start out with these things, I typically go a long way with a knife. Ah, I broke it. What am I gonna do? Throw it away and I'll keep going. Change it. That's why I didn't do the face yet, okay? So I'll come in here. Now the ball of the hat's gonna be back here. So now bring the ball of the hat back in here and bring it up and back down onto the face. Carving just got smaller. So I said in the past, your carving can always make your carving smaller. Don't want to give up on a piece of wood. Go with the flow. Don't be upset. I got lots of wood here. If I break this one, I got another piece back here I can use. Hope that tapping. That's my knife on the table. Hope that doesn't bother anybody. Sometimes I have a tendency to do that. Everybody's gonna say, oh man, what's he gonna do now? This guy doesn't have a plan. He just comes in and wastes our time carving a piece of wood. Like I got other things to do, sit here and watch this guy carve a piece of wood. Yeah, you can see the start of the break of the hatter a little bit. Okay, let's go up in there. Let's take this back in here. I just want to know where this ball is so that I stay away from it. Yeah, come in here. What I just did there was when I broke the top off, I just changed the carving. Okay, that's part of the reason that whenever I'm at a show, I'll have people come up and take a look at my carving and say, boy, is this one for sale? It's like, well, no, it's just sold. Well, could you make me another one? It's like, yeah, maybe. I might be able to, but maybe not. Do the best I can. Okay. Yeah. Take that off there a little bit. Okay. Now the hat's a little floppy and the ball on the hat will sit back on top of the rest of the hat. Just holler at me if I get off camera. I'm trying real hard to make sure that I stay close to the center of the screen as I can. And as I get into a little more detail, I'll bring it up so you guys can see some of the shadows and so forth. Oh yeah, there we go. I can catch it that way. Okay, you can see that right in here, I'm planning on doing something. I don't know what the heck it's gonna be yet, but I'm gonna do something. No, that's just gonna be where the hat's gonna flop over, okay? Now, I can face the, I'm gonna put the face in here, and I could bring this in here. I could put it over in here and have this coming around beside him. I can do whatever I want. If I wanna flip it around, I could probably sneak one in here and have it coming down in front of his eyes, coming from, but then he's gonna have a pretty weak chin. There's not a whole lot of wood to give. So I work on here or here. I've got a little bit more wood to work with. So that's probably where I'll go. Let me get my marker here, some of the wood chips out of my way. The last time I realized pencil just didn't quite show up very well. So I'm going to put the bottom of the hat in. I like to work off the bottom of the hat. If I know about where the bottom of the hat's going to be, I'm going to be like right in there with the bottom of this, the Santa hat. And then I'm going to slope it down. And whenever I get back here to the back, even though I'm still in a corner, I want that hat to be back in here, down in the bottom here. And as it comes around. So I can sketch that in. Okay. I don't worry about it being too straight because when I'm done, I don't really want the Santa hat to be too straight. I would rather, I don't know how many people you know that wear hats, but there's a few types of hats that people wear perfectly straight, but a Santa hat ain't one of them. Okay. Same thing as a beanie. They're not always straight. I don't know about me, but sometimes my hair, my ears sticking out of one side, but not the other. So come in here. And then whenever I'm doing the bottom of the hat, I will come in and I'll put cuts in. I'm going straight into the wood. I don't undercut anything yet. You don't want to undercut. I don't want to undercut. You might want to undercut. I don't want to undercut. The way I do it, if I do it this way, that way, if I need to move that hat up, I can move it up and it won't crawl back the head. If I need to make everything smaller, that cut's gonna stay right there. If I undercut too early, then I have to make the carving smaller and push and carve back into the wood further, then that line is gonna creep up the hat and the hat's gonna get further up on the head. So I like to not undercut, set the hat where I want it, and then carve the face to it, and then I can adjust the hat. Because I don't personally like to see my carvings when I am done grab one of these guys here, like this guy. Whenever I'm done with that hat, I want it to be there on his head. I don't want to have carved the face and then all of a sudden I push the hat back and it, the bottom of the hat way ends up way up on top of his head. That's why I try to go straight in as much as I can. And I do that with my ornaments as well. That piece, I probably won't carve that into something else. I can throw that one away. So I do have my limitations. But you'll notice I'm coming in here, get this in here and get this hat kind of roughed in. Okay, I'm still squarish, I'm still square, but you can see where the hat's gonna sit, all right? I'm not gonna worry that much about the fact that I'm square, but I am gonna take some of this off. Again, like I said, this is not, what I'm doing is using a scrap piece of wood and having some fun with it. This is a lot easier to do once you have carved for a while, working with either rough outs or cutouts and gone through, and you have an understanding of what the head is supposed to be shaped like. You can exaggerate it a little bit here and there. And what the expression looks like, you can exaggerate expressions, or if you got to tilt the eyes, or you're going to do something like that, how far you can go, and it still is recognizable as a caricature, and it's fun. You know, I always like my carvings to be fun. Whenever people pick up one of my carvings, I like it if they smile. I want them to really enjoy the personality of the carving, if at all possible. If I can accomplish that, then I've done what I needed to do with my carving. It's great. You get, as you're a carver, and you get to the point that, okay, well, now I can carve eyes and they look like eyes. You know, I carve a nose and it looks like a nose. Okay, then you get into the next step. Okay, now I can carve a little bit of expression and people smile at my carvings. They like it. He looks, you know, it's really nice. And I've said this before, one of the biggest compliments I'll get at a carving show is whenever somebody picks up my carvings and they say, I wonder what that guy's thinking. Because then they're not looking at that carving as just a piece of wood. They're looking at the caricature thinking that, yeah, that guy's, he's up to something, you know? There we go. Now, before I do a lot of detail on the hat, I'll just go ahead and get the face in here roughed in so that I know about where the face is. Now you'll see I'm gonna head this right down this line here. Whenever I carve a face, and especially for beginner carvers, you can carve it on the flat, but then you need to push it back into an angle because nobody's face is perfectly flat. You can make a face and carve it that it'll look great from the front, but as soon as you turn the carving sideways, the face will disappear. You have a carving and you want to be able to turn it. I'll grab this guy again. The face looks okay from the front. You want that face to look okay and him to have a nice profile too. There we go. You can see his eyes a little bit from the side. If you have somebody sitting beside you and you turn around and look at them, they don't have to look at you. You can still see their eyes. If you carve everything from the front, it might look great, but then you realize you didn't get any depth into the sides. So one thing that I like to do is I'll force it. If I, you know, get that degree going back from the nose to the ears, get that sloped back. Okay. Even in this case, I probably could sneak a couple ears in there, but I'm going to keep this bigger and just tuck his ears underneath his hair on this guy. Grab this guy here. This is a good example, because you can see there's two faces on this guy, but you can see there's a slope from the point of the nose back, from the point of the nose back. This guy has the same thing. His eyes are a little bit, back, but it's got two profiles there. You can see that it's coming back. You want to be able to see the carving from the side as well. And that takes a little bit of practice. If you're a new carver, it takes a little bit of practice. Just if you always make sure to look at the side of the carving as well as the front, yeah, it'll be fine. Now, what I'm going to do, I'm going to come in here. You'll notice I've been using I like this knife for a rough out knife. It gets a lot of wood off quickly, but I'm going to switch over to one that has an upsweep. I prefer using an upsweep knife. It's just a personal preference. It's not right or wrong. Everybody's got their favorite tools. And as far as I'm concerned, if it's sharp and it's what you like, then it's a great tool for you. There we go. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to come in here. I got the bottom of the hat established here. I don't take a lot of this wood away, like this stuff. I won't take a lot of that wood away quite yet because I'm not sure what I'm going to do with the hair, okay? But I want to know where the bottom of the hat is. There we go. I'm going to push that face back in. I'm going to come across and I'm going to cut right at the bridge of the nose. I want to put the bridge of the nose in. Let's just come in here. There we go. There we go. That's where the bridge of the nose is going to be. Okay. And I get it back there and I take my knife. I come right down along the side. Get that over there. Take this down at a little bit of an angle right there. And I'll just scoop a little bit. Extend that down. Come to the other side. I'm going to do the same thing. There we go. Now you can see a little bit about where the bridge of the nose. This is where the eyes are going to be, but hey, I'm not that far yet. One thing I'll warn you against, especially if you're a beginner carver, don't put detail in too early. Because as soon as you need to change something or something breaks off the top, you've done the detail work and you get to do it again. Or you end up with really nice looking carving and you realize, I got to change it. So I don't do detail work very early. All right, let's see where I'm going with this. This is whenever I like to do a little bit of, I like to decide what I'm going to do with expression a little bit. If I'm going to raise an eyebrow or whatever, I usually will try and choose it pretty soon. I look at the side. I want to make sure that if I'm doing a head here, his head is going to go up in this hat, okay? I don't want the hat way back here. Or if you're doing a baseball cap, that's one thing. If you're doing a baseball cap, it's really easy to end up with the brim of the baseball cap out here, and you got the baseball cap, and you realize that the front of the baseball cap's here, but his forehead's way back in here. You take a look at it from the side, make sure that it looks the way you want it to. Get up here. Oh yeah, that's a little better. Yeah, I like talking to myself. It's a good thing because that's what I'm doing. I'm sitting here talking to myself. And my own best, yeah, I can keep myself company for hours on end. All right. This is the type of thing too that I like to do these kinds of small carvings, especially if I'm out and about. You see me at a picnic, family get together. I mean, all of my relatives know I carve. They would be surprised if they see me in their backyard at a picnic and I'm not holding a piece of wood and a knife, because it's just something I do. And it's a good icebreaker, gets people interested in carving. I think it's all really good if we can, you know, get people interested in doing this type of thing. And I'll tell you, I can't tell you how many people have come up to me outside of stores and at parks and so forth, and they see you with a knife and a piece of wood. They you're doing something that maybe they've never seen before. And that's something else. Yeah.
Yeah, it's Dan. I was just curious, what kind of knife do you take out into the field with you?
I have some folding knives. I have a couple of ore carvers that I carve with. Yep. That are locking blades. But then I've also picked up some good pocket knives, even at flea markets. That if you get back in the pocket knives were made before the 70s. They'll have usually carbon and better steel in them. Right. And some of the better made knives, the old Camillus knives, Imperials, some of those, you can get, you have to work at them, get a decent edge on them. But most of my daily carries that I carry is a pocket knife in my pocket all the time. Usually you'll have at least one blade sharpened that I can carve with.
And I see you use a lot of helvy knives.
I have a lot of helvy knives. I'm a sucker for knives. I don't think you can be a carver without being a sucker for knives. I have helvies. I have lions. I have a couple of Dave Notto knives. I like three of them. I really like his knives. Drake. This one's a Mike Shipley OCCT. I like his knives. It's a good stiff blade. Mainly the blades that you use and the knives you use is a personal preference. And like I said, this is a Helvy. I like Helvies. I've been buying Helvies since the early 90s, and they're good knives. Some of the knives you get a Helvy or a Lions from Dave Lions or Drake, you're gonna get it and you're gonna be able to carve with it. You don't have to do any work to it. The main thing is keeping after it. One thing I'll mention here, especially for new carvers, I carve across the grain. As soon as that thing starts to haze a little bit, I strop it because that you got to keep after it. You just keep it stropped. I've got knives that I've had here for 20 years. I've never taken to a stone because I keep them sharp. And it does make a difference. You don't want to get, or if you're carving, you see a little bit of a line. Oh, it's time to strop. Don't keep going. You know, strop it and keep it sharp. Okay. Well, I'm going to come in here. That's where basically you can see where the eyes are going to be. I'll fool with the eyebrows and so forth later. I want to put the nose here on this guy. Round out a little bit. I'm going to come in underneath the nose next and just put right underneath the nose. I'm going to come in. Let's put it about here. Yeah, that's a good place. There we go. There we are. I don't want to go too far. And what I do is whenever I go in, I'm going to immediately turn it sideways and take a look at the profile. I want to know, where is this in relationship to the bridge? How far do I want to push the bridge in? This one, I want to push the bridge in a little further. Keeping in mind that this is where the bridge of the nose is. There we go. Make it a little deeper. I like a little deeper set eyes. I can get a little bit more expression out of them. Okay, if I do this, I mean, I got lots of wood. I got all the way back into here I can use. So I got lots of wood. So I'll come in here. As soon as I do that, I start to think, okay, maybe his face is getting back a little farther. Let's push this hat back. There we go. Start to pull his hat back a little bit. I'll keep this out in case I want to do a rough out there. I do Santas with a rough around his hat. I do Santas with a hillbilly hat. I'll put a ball on top of anything called a Santa. But, yeah, getting there. There we go. Now, I'm going to switch over a little bit to another knife and just something that has a little bit more delicate blade on it. And I'm going to come in here on either side of the nose. I'll just take a little bit here. I just want to see, I always make my noses a little wider than what I really want them to be at the end, because if you don't, they'll end up too narrow. That's pretty good. Now, I'm going to grab a U-gouge here, number 11. That's kind of big. That's okay. And I'm going to use a gouge and come up on either side of the nose, up into where the eye is. I'm looking for my pencil right now. So there you see my hand moving like this and I'm twisting around. I'm looking for something. I guess you guys always are organized. I'm not that organized all the time. I don't usually do this, but I'm going to sketch this in here. Turn that so you can see it a little bit. Nope, right in here. I put a couple pencil marks. A little difficult to see. There we go. Darken them up a little. There you go. Okay, I'm not going to carve a long limb. They're just in a direction. I'm going to keep in mind with how wide the nose is and then how wide I want the bridge of the nose up in here. I'm going to use a U-gouge. I'm going to push right in along that. Come right in. Little tab there. Do the other side. Little tab. Narrow it down a little more. Using the same gouge, I'm going to come across the eye, and it'll come out. Now, if your gouge is sharp, you can cheat it and go this way on this eye. Whoop, go this way with this eye. If it's not real sharp, you come back across, but you don't want to cut the bridge of the nose off, okay? You don't want to go all up, you know, yeah, oh, now you get to carve another nose, which isn't a big deal because there's lots of wood there and you can always make your carving smaller. There we go.
Get a little smaller gouge.
We've got a number 9 over here. Here we go. I'll come in and clean that up. I'm not real happy with that. I get a little soft spot in the wood there. Just quite, yeah, there you go. A little bit of a tear. I want that area down in there to be real clean. When I go to do the eyes, I want that area down in where these eyes are going to go to be real clean. And I'm going to narrow the bridge of that nose. Okay. Typically, you have two eyes. There should be room in between the two eyes for, I'm going to switch this around here a little bit. Boom. Coming back to me. Two eyes, room between the two eyes for a third eye. Okay. That's a human figure, that five eyes wide from, and it's actually from out here into the corner of your eye, and then you have an eye width coming in, and then room for one more in the middle. Five eyes wide, and some people will, you'll hear that. It's just the proportions, you know. But with caricatures, you can give one that a little bit. I find it with my carvings, if I set the eyes a little closer, they get a little friendlier. They're just a little friendlier looking to me. If I'm going to do a boxer, okay, or a butcher, okay, somebody that's got some years to him, okay, then I'll take his eyes apart a little bit, okay, it'll give him more of a bulldog stance. A Marine sergeant, somebody that's got some grunt to him, then I'll move his eyes a little bit. I'm going to do a Santa, somebody that I want to be kind of friendly looking, I'll put his eyes a little closer. Okay, that coupled with narrowing his temples down a little bit will just, to me, give the carving a little friendlier look. That's what I'm after. I like a little friendlier look. I'm gonna switch this back around because you guys are tired of looking at me. There we go. Get back on my tape marks. Hey, back where I was. My glasses on. Good to go. Okay. Hopefully we haven't lost too many people yet. Yeah, I get rid of some of my wood chips. You're getting in my way. There we go. Okay, back. All right. Like I said, I want to smooth this out a little bit. I want that to be as smooth as I can. All right, I will carve these things and then I'll come back in and I'll fool with them for quite a while, cleaning them up. But the one thing I do take a little bit of time with is in around the eyes. Now, this nose has some corners on the bridge of the nose coming up in, and I don't know if you can see, maybe you can see it a little bit. There's a couple of corners there. I just take my knife and I'm gonna round them out because people don't have corners on their nose. There we go. Hey, Shape that nose back a little bit. Look at it from the bottom. I want to make sure that the nose is shaped a little bit. Okay. There we go. Now, there again, I'm coming in here is where the, say I'm going to put a mustache. I can do whatever I want, you know, just decide as I go. I've done carving, Santa carvings and elf carvings. Let's see, everything I have here has a mustache and a beard. Sometimes I don't. I'll do an elf and I won't bother with a mustache. You know, I'll just get my beard done. But this guy here, he's going to have both. Okay, so now I'm going to come down here. What am I going to do with the mouth? I just want to get the mound in for the mouth.
Jim, I have a question.
Yeah, great. I'm glad to hear it. Somebody's out there and they want to talk to me. Oh, boy.
I hope it's a good question. Funny. I bet you're the hood of the party. Oh, my gosh. But, you know, I can see a Santa and I can also see an elf. How would you, if you did go into an elf, what would be the difference between a Santa and an elf in your carving?
Not a whole lot. Sometimes with elves, I'll try to give them ears, or I'll give them a little bit bigger ears. And then sometimes I'll do elves without a mustache. They'll just have a beard. I'll take the mustache off and give them a little bit more of an elfish look in that his face is a little smaller. The beard is a little bushier. With a Santa, I give them more of a either a jolly look or something. But most of these guys can be considered Santas or elves. But if I'm doing specifically an elf, then I'll sometimes take the mustache off. That's really it.
All right, thank you.
Sure. If you think of anything else you want to ask, please do. I'm going to come down here with my U gouge, the same U gouge that I was using up in here. I'm just going to come down through here, in between the eyebrows. See if I can do it whenever you can see it. I'll do it upside down, right in the rear, down to the bridge of the nose. And boom. Just to get a little bit of a divot there between the eyebrows. Now the eyebrows may be back in farther. I'm just doing that myself so that I know about where everything is. Now I'm gonna come in here and some of you younger people might not realize this until you get a little older. Oop. Here I am. But as I get a little older, these creases right here get deeper and deeper. I know when I was 12, my face didn't look like this, but it's very useful when you're carving because you can take a look in the mirror and see that these are deeper and they connect right here above the nose, not down here. They connect at the top of the wings. So I want to do this and that line is going to come down and help to define the mound for the mouth. Okay. This line is not, and if you can see underneath my mustache, my mouth, whenever I'm grinning, doesn't go all the way back to that line. There's still a little bit there. So I'm going to put this crease in. This is going to define the bottom of the cheek and also the edge of the mound of the mouth. Go back to my carving. Back on my tape. If I don't get back on my tape, then you guys can't see what I'm doing. I'm going to come up in here now, just like I said. And I'm going to use the other pen. What did I do with my pen? There it is. Make it a little darker. See if my Sharpie will stop working on me. There we go. I'm going to come off there. And there, I want to decide what I'm going to do with the mouth. I'm straight. I've got a pretty straight line coming right down between the eyes, bridge of the nose, down the nose, okay? You can push a nose one way or the other a little bit to give them a little bit of expression, a little bit of style. You can do a straight symmetrical carving. That's okay too, if that's your preference. It's just kind of boring for me. I enjoy trying to push the mouth one way or the other. Oh, if I'm gonna open the mouth, I'll open it on one side or the other. Sometimes I'll just give a big toothy grin like I have on a couple of these guys. But right here is where I'm going to decide which way I want to do it. Now, this guy to me, and I go as I go, that guy right now is looking over his left shoulder. Whenever I'm looking at a piece of wood, I'm trying to think, okay, where am I going with this? That guy's looking over his left shoulder. He doesn't have shoulders, but he's looking over his left shoulder. Okay. Just because of the shape of the wood on this side versus this side. So if he's looking over his left shoulder, which way do I want his eyes? Where do I want to raise an eye? Maybe not. Decide as I go. I'm going to bring this in, and I think I'm going to go. Tough decision. It's almost 4. Let's go this way and up a little bit. Bring that down. There we go. So I'm going to go ahead and bring this in down, and this one and down. There we go. Come in here to the corner, and I'm going to push my knife into the face. I am not pushing under the nose. I'm pushing into the face, straight into the face. Even if the wood, drop them, there we go. Even if the wood is coming in, I'm pushing straight into the wood, not under the nose. Okay, some people make the mistake, and whenever they push that in there, they go under the nose, and it ends up undercutting the nose, and their nose gets smaller. Okay, now I'm gonna come down right here, take a little triangle out of there. Gives a little bit of a shadow. I'll come in here and do the other side. Straight into the face. Come up underneath, take that out of there. That defines the bottom of the cheek. I'm gonna come up to my stop cut because I did my stop cut around there. Okay. There we go. If it doesn't come out, push in again. There we are. Yeah. Okay, now we got it. Now, there is something here that I do go by a little bit. The distance from the bridge of the nose to the bottom of the nose is about the same distance as the bottom of the nose to the chin, if the mouth is closed, to the bottom of the chin. So if I go here to here, the bottom of his chin would be about here. I can cheat it. I can pull it down a little more if I want. He's going to have a beard, but that's still important because I need to know what I'm doing with the mouth. Now, he has got a little bit of a cheeks pushed up here, so I can grin him a little bit. I can do it. I can do give him a grin. I can come in here and I can do a couple things. I can come in here and I can just do this. If you're doing a quick Santa, come in here with the bottom and just come down there, put a little lip in there, and I'm fine. But it's 4 o'clock and we can go for a little while yet, I'm assuming, Blake.
So yeah, we'll shoot for about 4:30.
Okay, good. So I can come in here and I can do a little bit more with that. So I'm gonna leave the marks on there, but I'm gonna bring this in and I'm just gonna come out and I'm gonna go like that. And I'm gonna come down, I'm gonna come out and over and about like that. And get rid of this, undercut the mustache. There we go. That gives me a little bit more room to play with. There we go. Now, his chin's down here, from there to there. So that's good. I'm good. Okay. I got that face roughed in here now. I can do what I want. I know where everything is. So I can come in here and I can take care of some of this stuff. Take some of these corners off. All right. Let's work around, take some of this off just to soften him a little bit around. I'm gonna grab my other knife here. Okay, take that off there. There we go. couple things I do want to show you. Now, some of the people, I guess, are experienced carvers. You know what you're doing, maybe with the eyes. Some people aren't experienced, and the eyes are a struggle. Typically, eyes, hands, noses, ears, those always seem tough, but that's also what's fun. Okay. I'm going to do some eyes in there, but I want to get, like right now, I could put eyes in there, but what I want is I want them to have, when I look at the front of them, I want to see hair. I want to see the sideburns. If I carve the eyes now, tendency would be to carve the eyes all the way out to the edge of the wood. I don't want to do that. I want to come in here and I'm going to come right in beside with the same gouge that I used in the eyes. And I'm going to come in and I'm just going to go whoop, up against the hat on both sides, leaving the cheek and narrowing the temples. Take my knife up under the hat, which I haven't undercut yet. There we go. If I bring him up a little bit, you can see that that's where his hair is going to be. That's where his temple is. Okay. That limits how big my eyes are going to be. That's why I haven't carved any eyes yet. Okay. There we go. Profile. Profile still looks okay. Can have bushy eyebrows. That's okay. Yeah, I'm happy with that. Is not cleaning up as much as I'd like it to. There we go. That's not too bad. Okay. Now, a couple things. Let's go ahead and get a couple eyes in here. All right. Okay, what I'm going to do is I want to raise an eye a little bit. I want to raise one. Raise an eyebrow. I'm going to come in here and I'm going to take this up a little bit here. There we go. Boom. Raise that eyebrow a little bit. Guy's going to look that way when I'm done. Okay, he's going to be looking over his shoulder this way, but he's going to be looking that way. I'll come in here, right in, and I'll get my gouge, clean this up a little bit more, right in beside the bridge of the nose. Isn't it fascinating to know what a carver, and actually be able to listen to what a carver is thinking while he's carving? That's great. Typically, people don't want to know. They want to know what I'm thinking. But, hey. Then you got people like Bob Hershey that is always fascinated at everything I say. Bob must have left. I didn't even get anything out of him. Man.
Question, Jim.
Yeah.
are you a married man?
Yes, I am.
Does your wife talk to you?
Oh, sure. Yeah. Oh,
you just seem really lonely while you're carving.
Well,
sorry, it wasn't carving related, and it's probably none of my business.
Yeah, she's not in a room right now. That's something to keep in mind when you're carving, though. You know, you're your own worst critic, unless you're married.
Okay. Hey, Jim.
Yeah.
Do you happen to have any of your non-Santa scraps within reach, just kind of to show what else you do with them?
Let me look. I'm looking around, you know, it is Christmas time.
Oh, I love Santas and I love Christmas, but I'm just curious of what else you do.
Yeah, well, this guy here I'm working on, he's gonna be holding a stick of dynamite. This is gonna, or firecracker. He's got a rag in his back pocket. I do a lot of this type of stuff. Trying to see what I do have back there. Most everything out right now is Christmas related.
Okay.
Yeah. I figured that this is the holidays. This would be the best thing to do today.
Jim, do you carve Santas all year long or mostly during this time?
No, I carve them all year long. I like to carve Santas, elves, wizards, baseball players. I've carved turtles, elephants. Anything that I can put a caricature face on, I like to carve. I have to say that I enjoy carving. I probably, if I pick up a piece of wood and I just carve, it's going to be a Santa or a wizard. I just like to do that. But I'm doing with the eyes now. Oh, I'm sorry.
No, I just say great job.
Oh, thanks. What I'm doing is
Jim,
I'm
pushing do you, in.
I'm sorry.
I'm sorry. Do you only teach in the Lancaster area or do you do any of the roundups or anything?
I haven't done any of the roundups. I'm still a working man, so I'm not able to do a lot of traveling around. But I've taught in around Lancaster. We had one scheduled for Kentucky to do like almost a mini roundup. Me and Bob Hershey and Jim Heiser were going to go out to Kentucky in the spring, but then the COVID has had other things in mind, so we didn't do that. But I think we're still planning on it for next year, hopefully. What I'm doing is I'm coming in the corners of the eye, if anybody's interested. And I just sketch where the eyes are. I'm pushing in at the corners and in the corner here, and then also on the outside. And the outside of the eye on this side. And I pop the corners out. If it doesn't pop out, then I don't pry it. Come back in and push it in again. So it does pop out. Otherwise you get the little fuzzies in the corners of the eye. I have a, there we go. Yeah, I've done a lot of different kinds of, I've done cowboys and run the gamut. I actually keep a list in my phone of carving ideas of anytime I see somebody's doing something, Civil War soldier, something like, I'll go ahead and I'll put it on my list. I've got a few carvings on I've got a friend of mine that's a fireman. I've done some firemen. I've done a few women. They're a little bit more challenging, just because when you're doing a caricature, it's pretty easy to end up with what looks like a man in drag, and that's not always what I'm going for when I'm carving a girl. But
Jim, could you move the carving back a little? It's off the
back
screen.
Back a little. There.
Much better, thank you.
Sure. Okay. Once I get that, let me get the eyes in here. Open my toothbrush. Get some of the fuzzies out of there.
Jim, could you go over the transition between the cheeks and the eyes, please?
You mean
where the cheeks meet the bottom of the eye?
Yeah, right in here.
Yeah.
What I did was I took the corners out in the corner of the eye. I brought a real small step stop cut from corner to triangle, and I come down over the eyeball. Okay.
Thank you.
The same thing on this side. Yep. Do the same thing. Now, whenever I'm done, a couple things I'll do, usually with a much smaller gouge than that. There we go. I'll come in and I'll come up over the cheek. Let me switch around and show you. What I'll do is I'll come up over the cheek. I'll make an S cut. I start with my gouge. I come up over the cheek, down, and then up in here. And that defines the bottom of the bag underneath the eye. I also take a small U gouge and I'll go above the eye. And I'll come up underneath here. That defines the top of the upper eyelid. Whenever I do this type of a carving, that's what I do. I don't always do the eyes the same, but that's typically the way I would teach it. I got to switch back. Are you going to look at my wall? There we go. So I'm going to take this gouge, and it's like a 3 millimeter, number 11. And I'm just going to come in right up over and down. I'm not, you may not even see it, but if you're holding a carving this small, you would see it. I like the faces a little soft. Let me see if I can get a shadow to catch it. You can see it, just a little bit of a shadow at the bottom of the eyelid there. Sometimes with the camera, it's a little, there we go, a little better. Okay, you can see on this side, I'm gonna come up over, down, and then back up. It just defines the top. Let me see if I can catch the shadow again. A little bit right there. And I'll take a smaller one, maybe a 2 millimeter. I'm going to come up in underneath the eye, underneath or above the eye, underneath the eyebrow. I'm just going to divot that up in there. Just come in above the eye. If when I'm done with this, the eye is a little bug-eyed, then I'll push the eyes back in a little further. Okay. When I do this, then I bring my knife right at the corner of the eye. I'm going to extend it down a little bit and then tuck that lower eyelid right up underneath that upper eyelid and do the same thing on this side. Okay. Now I'm going to come in here. I'm going to do a little bit of a put the pupils in. Give the guy a little personality here. There we go. Okay, you can see where I'm going with it. There we go. Now, since I know that's where it's going to be up here, time is it? I don't have time yet. That's pretty good.
Jim, would you do it? Are you going to do wings on his nose, or will you just leave his nose round there?
I'm going to do his wings on his nose. And what I do, I can show you now what I do. I come in here with my knife, and everybody does these a little bit differently. Some people will take a U-gouge and just push in there and then carve down to it. I take my knife and I come in, and I'm going to go up toward the front of the nose, turn my knife, and come up beside the nose. Yeah, with my hand. There you go, where I'm ending up. See if I can get my thumb out of the way, and then maybe it'll focus. And do the same thing on the other side. Maybe this side will show up a little better on the camera. In, and then up. And I take that out. And I talk to Jim Heiser. And I showed him one time how I do this. He does the same cut, but he does the other direction. He comes from the top down and then around. It's like, Jim, that's a wrong way to do it. There isn't a wrong way, but he does it the wrong way. Okay, and around that off. Okay. Take a small gouge, that'll be a good one. Let's get some nostrils in here so you can breathe. And I'm pushing in up underneath for a nostril. I'm going to come in and do the same thing on this side. A little bit further up. Take my knife underneath it and pop that out. Underneath and pop that out. This side's going to be a little bit bigger. I like to do the nostrils before I line or do any other work with the mustache. If I have a little edge on it, around them. Clean it up a little. And take this off. Now, one thing about the faces that I do, when I come in and I do this, I will take my knife then and take edges off. I like to see tooling marks, but on the faces, I like it to be a little softer. So I'll just round them up a little bit. Get that out of there, that out of there. Okay, come in here and come in above it. Get the eyebrows to pop out a little bit. Up under the hat. Now I can come in and start to undercut a little bit because I know what I'm doing here. Okay. Yeah. Okay. That's not too bad. He's got a little bit of a friendly look to him. Now, if I want to, I can pull this up a little bit. And you can change, make it, if you don't go too deep, you can make some changes here and there. Let's pull his mustache up a little, just on that side. Okay. And now, let's come in here. We're going to open that side of his mouth up a little bit. Okay. Push this back in a little deeper. That mouth up. Now, if I take my gouge, I come underneath that. Give him a little bit of a lower lip. Make sure I'm still on screen. I'm looking at the carving, not the screen. There we go. Soften it up a little bit.
Hey, Jim, we have someone from Argentina that's on with us, and they're wanting to know if you have an Instagram or YouTube account or a Facebook page.
I have a Facebook page. Jim Feather Wood Carver, my Facebook page. Yep. I don't have Instagram, although my daughter tells me I should. I should listen to my daughter. Just open his mouth up a little bit. Now, I'm going to go ahead and do the hat. Is it 20 after? Okay, I want to go do the hat just to show you guys a little bit about what I do with the hat. I'm going to put a rough around this one. So I'll just come up, and I'm not measuring, I'm not sketching it, I'm just looking at it. Because whenever this guy pulls his hat on, he doesn't always get it straight. It's part of his personality. And mainly what I want to do this for, I'd like to talk to you guys about getting the hat to look like it's laying correctly. It's easy to do a hat and make it perfectly symmetrical, but it's also boring. Okay. And you wanna have clothes that have wrinkles in them, divots in them. Maybe they're not quite laying the way they're supposed to be. There we go. So that does that. Now I've got this hat coming in here. Let's get the ball and the hat going. Anybody else has any questions? I can answer questions as I go. Glad I had somebody from Argentina. That's the first. It's kind of neat whenever you put a picture on Facebook and see where that thing goes, especially if your post is shared. One time I had one that ended up going to Europe and then Eastern Europe and then to Asia. And if they have their settings correctly, whenever they do the share, you can see who shares what. It's like, don't the people in Asia have anything better to do than to look at my car? But.
Hi, Jim. Wondering if you do any classes in person in Lancaster and where at, and if that's on your Facebook page?
I do at times. Conowego Carvers in... I've done those for with Conowego Carvers for several years, and I do a caricature class. There's also Hillcrest Carving here that is a little shop that I do classes at occasionally, but usually once or twice a year I'll do a class over at for the Conowego Carvers.
Thanks. I just discovered that Hillcrest place yesterday. I'm going to take a visit there on Monday.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, Don Schwartz. He's a good guy. He's a carver, too. That's what he's a good guy. And usually we'll get something going on in there occasionally. Now, we haven't done anything, obviously, this year. Classes have been kind of limited. Okay, what I'm going to do is I'm showing you here a little bit about the hat. I'm going to have some wrinkles in the hat. One thing that I try to do is, like, I don't want a perfectly symmetrical hat. And if I'm going to put a crease in a hat, for instance, like right here, let's put a little divot there, okay? I put the divot in. Then off of the side of that divot, I'll do it another divot at a slightly different angle, okay? It gives it a little bit nicer look. Underneath here, this is going to have some weight to it. So why not do it again underneath? Put the wrinkles in the clothing so that it looks like the hat's pushed a little bit. Okay, so let's scoop a little. Oh, I dropped the curve. There you go. Okay, and then come in where it's going to crease right in there. It makes it a little bit more interesting. And then I will come into the end of it and just scoop it a little bit to kind of taper it out. The same thing on the other side. This is coming in this way. I will do that. And then in here, I will do that. I like them to be a little bit more haphazard so that it looks like it's really just folded, but not evenly folded. Do the same thing in the sleeves of a shirt. Okay.
Jim, I have trouble with the creases. I just don't know where to put them. And, you know, I can see cutting underneath and then you're cutting from the top, but I just have trouble knowing where to put them. And then I end up doing it and they look fakey.
Oh, my suggestion is to take a look in the mirror, look at your blouse or your shirt and see what the creases look like. If you have, put this around here again. Okay, if you come into the corner of the creases here, there's gonna be a crease coming this way. There's gonna be also a crease coming out this way. Mm. You see where the creases are here, okay? Take a look at where gravity is going to pull the clothing. It's not that easy. If you put just an even crease, it will look a little bit fake. But if you can pull the creases in and let it drape down over, I don't know if that'll help you at all, but that's kind of what I look for, you know?
So get away from the straight crease that may be fatter on one side than it is the other, the way that
Yeah, that's why I like to do it with a knife, you know? I don't want it to be even, like the hat there. You know, I got two coming out there. But really, this has got some weight to it, so there could be another small one right in there.
Okay, thank you.
A little bit of a roll, okay? Now, as far as, what time is it? It's 25 after. Far as hair and beard on this guy, I'll come in a lot of times with this. Well, see, a lot of times I will go ahead and do a little bit of a sketch. Just, I want to know basically the direction of the hair, where it's going. Okay. So I can put a couple of lines in here, just showing the basic direction. Now, when I do hair, and I'm going to do it with my knife, I can do it with a gouge. I typically will use a lot of U-gouges, but I like to use a knife, especially up here. I'll come in and I'll cut in. Then I'll come up under it. Okay, come in and cut in. And I try not to make a real straight cut. And then come up in underneath it. That gives the look that the hair is weighted down. It is layering from the top down. The same thing here. I can bring that on out and back in. Now, when you get back in here, I don't want to go too far because his jawline's underneath there. So I can scoop that out a little bit. I can bring this down underneath for his chin. Let his mustache come out a little bit. And I could do this carving just with a knife, but I can come back in also with a gouge and then do some other U-cuts in around, catching it cross grain a little bit. Okay. And then around this way, up in. Let's come down here and up underneath. You see, I'm still working with the basic shape of the scrap wood that I started with. If I was doing it straight off of a block or a pattern, this would already be laid out as exactly where it want, where it should be, but I'm not too worried about the haphazardness of it. He's got some in his nose there. Yeah. I used to work with a girl that said, hey, he's got a hanger in his closet. Okay, a couple more things here with the gouges. I'll come back in with a U-gouge once I do some of these cuts, okay? And this is a number three millimeter, I think, number 11. And I'll come in and I'm gonna go ahead and I'm gonna do a little bit here. I want enough of a catch that whenever I do the hair and paint it, that the paint, I can do a little bit of maybe dry brushing on it and get it to catch. I want a little bit of shadow in the hair. But I want hair masses. I don't want a zebra look. Clean that out of there. I'm running out of time here a little bit now to finish him up, but just to give you an idea. I will use a little bit of a gouge mark here, keeping in mind that his chin's under there. And then I'll go back in with a smaller gouge for his mustache. But I'm gonna do small, short, scooping cuts. I'm not doing all the way down from the bottom to the top. Do that a little bit. And I'll show you one more thing with the mustache. I'll come down through and do the whole mustache that way. And then what I'll do is I'll come down in here to the bottom of the mustache. I'm going to take little triangles out. And you want to go right along with the direction of the mustache, the hair. And take a little bit out there. Make it a little bit. I don't want it to be perfectly even. He's not. He's kind of a rougher guy. There we go. Down. There we go. That's what we have here so far. So I got a lot of cleanup to do on them. Clean them up, make them look like the other ones. I think we're coming up on 4:30. I don't know how far you guys want to go.
Yeah, if anybody else has any other questions for Jim, go ahead and throw them out there. We'll wrap it up here. Short amount of time.
Jim, I've got a quick question, if you don't mind.
Sure.
I don't know if you were going to speak about this or not, but I was just wondering how you usually go about painting your carvings.
Oh, with painting.
Yeah, obviously you can't go through it in detail, but do you use boiled linseed oil first?
I do. What I typically do is I'll mix up boiled linseed oil with, I like raw sienna oil paint. and I'll mix it up to about a mixture that is about a honey or butterscotch color. And then I flood the carving with it. I either brush it on or dunk it. And then I let it dry for a day or two. And then I paint. And I don't have to. I mean, I've painted it wet and that's fine. But if I let it dry a day or two, I think I get a little bit more consistent look to it. Might just be my imagination. But I use, then I use thinned acrylics and I paint with thinned acrylics. And I do it very, depending on the paint, very, very thinned. Like the red is thin. I like to see the wood through. The back of the hat here, the, you know, this is all the same color as the boiled linseed oil mixed with raw sienna. And then for face flesh tone, I'll take, I like burgundy, but there's a red, reddish brown color. And then I'll thin it way down to real, real thin. And I'll do like a wash over the face. Eyes, teeth, I do full strength. They're very close to full strength. And then I'll do a little bit more of the burgundy color in the mouth, tip of the nose, cheeks, that type of thing. And then the beard, I'll dry brush with full strength titanium white on the Santas. But yeah, that's basically what I do.
Thank you. I was interested because I've started using the white linseed oil myself recently, and I found if I leave it for a day to dry, I get a more consistent color that when I paint it the second day rather than when it's wet. So that's interesting, but thank you. I appreciate it.
Yeah. Yeah. That's what I do. It seems to be a little bit more consistent. But like I said, I've done it both ways.
Sometimes it's great. Thank you very much.
Yep.
Excellent.
Jim, I've seen the flesh color in different places and faces, and besides the nose tip and the cheeks, is there other places that you use to put that little flesh color in?
Yep. Hands, ankles, anything that's showing flesh, I'll do the same thing with. I have a guy in shorts, legs. But mostly hands, just mostly the face. I like to get it to where it has a soft look to it. I want the skin tone to be kind of soft. And that's why you really, if you're holding the carving, you're not going to see a thick paint on the face on one of my carvings. The boiled linseed oil mix gets it very close. And then whenever I do a little bit of, I have to do this, maybe get a little better. But whenever I do a little bit of the flesh tone or the thin burgundy, then it'll help soften it a little bit more.
Okay, is that on his forehead too, or underneath his eyebrows?
Yeah, underneath his eyebrows. I'll paint the eyes, and then I'll just flood the whole thing, the whole face. And I get back into just the edge of the hair because I want that skin to be going back in underneath his hair a little bit too.
Okay, thank you.
Sure.
So your skin color is the boiled linseed oil and raw sienna?
Boiled linseed oil, raw sienna for the whole carving. Then I go back in over the flesh tone, over the skin tone with thinned burgundy. And it's thinned like, well, I've said before, like Kool-Aid thin. It's like a water, like a colored water. And I'll just go over it. If it needs a little darker, I'll go over it again, sometimes two or three times. And then I'll go back over the nose, cheeks, and the mouth, lip, just to get them a little bit darker. This guy has a tongue. And I'll get back in there with the tongue. Yeah.
Jim, do you thin down your raw sienna? I do something similar, but I use the Minwax natural instead of the linseed oil.
The raw sienna and the linseed oil, what I do is I will take and mix mineral spirits with the raw sienna to get it to where it will pour. Then I'll mix it with the boiled linseed oil because it's not a whole lot of tint. It's just enough to get it tinted a little bit. You can use Minwax, the 201, I think it is. The natural Minwax. You can use that and you'll get a similar look. The boiled linseed oil has a little bit more of a yellower look, I guess. With the raw sienna oil paint, I like it. If I'm doing a carving like I do a night watchman in the, and I want them to be in the dark. Then I'll sometimes use different oil paints to mix with the boiled linseed oil to give them a little darker look. I've even used a little bit of walnut stain in with it to get a darker shadow to make it look a little bit of a darker carving. And some of it depends on the wood too. You know, what color wood that you started with, how light the wood is, and basically what color you end up. So you have to kind of make adjustments.
Hey Jim, we're coming up on about 25 till 5, so I'm going to go ahead and stop you now and say thank you for coming on and doing your demonstration for us. Again, thanks for taking all the time out to prepare for this. And hopefully, if you have time or if you get a chance, at least once you get that guy painted up, if you'll send us pictures over so that we can share that with everybody. Everybody will probably be interested in seeing what it looks like once you're finished. So thanks again for doing the demonstration for us. Don't forget, next week we'll have Larry Green on. That'll be on December the 5th. We'll then have Ryan Olson, Wayne Larimore, and off the week of Christmas, and then Mike Pounder's coming in at the beginning of January. I just want to remind everybody about the Wood Carving Academy that started up with our meeting when we had Dave Stetson on. If you're looking for some classes outside of just a lot of stuff, you want to go out and check out Wood Carving Academy and see what they have offered out there. Again, thank you, Jim, for joining us, and thank you all for signing on and being with us this afternoon. And we'll see you all next Saturday.
Okay.